Hi, I'm Mr. Parshuram Shinge with an interesting and learning episode of B.Pharm on the important unit of bacterial enzyme 2, which is very important unit of the section of pharmaceutical microbiology, third semester. Let's start with our episode while taking a look at what we are going to learn today. Module 1, Introduction to Importance of Enzyme. Module 2, Study of Amylases. Module 3, Study of Protease. Module 4, Study of Streptodonase. Module 5, Immobilization of Bacteria. Module 6, Immobilization of Plant Cell. Let's start with a general introduction about enzyme in our Module 1. Microbial enzymes are most extensively employed in food and beverage industries across the globe to meet the ever-increasing demand for the nutritionally superb and high-value products. Enzymes are also required for carrying out various synthesis reactions in the living body. Evidently, the articulated synthesis of protein, nucleic acid, phospholipid for cell membrane, hormones and glucagon all essentially need at least one, if not many enzymes. For instance, DNA polymerase is extremely needed for carrying out the phenomena of DNA replication that precedes mitosis. Even blood clotting, the formation of angiotensin II to boost up blood pressure and the transport of carbon dioxide in a blood also require specific enzymes. In this lecture, we will study few important enzymes like amylases, proteases and streptodonase. Module 2, Study of Amylases. After having a small introduction about the enzymes, now we will study few enzymes one by one. Let's start with the amylase enzyme. Amylase are basically digestive enzymes which hydrolyzes glycosidic bond in a starch to glucose, maltose and dextrin. Based on the copious volumes of information with regards to the utilization of the amylases in rather wider spectrum of the Gen 1 involved products, one may classify them into two well-known categories, namely 1. Alpha amylase, 2. Beta amylases. Now we'll see these enzymes along with their biological sources. 1. Alpha amylases, which is also called as diastase. Chemically, it is known as 1,4-alpha glucan-glucanohydrolase, which are basically the extracellular enzyme that specifically hydrolyzes alpha-1,4 glycosidic bonds. In a recent literature, these enzymes are referred as endoenzymes. Biological source: alpha amylase producing bacteria are Bacillus subtilis, Bacillus cereus, Bacillus amyloliquefaciens, Bacillus coagulans, etc. Alpha amylase producing fungi are Aspergillus, Candida, Cephalosporium, Neurospora, Penicillium and Rhizopus. Second, beta amylases, chemically known as alpha-1,4 glycan maltohydrolases, which are belongs to the plant origin, but there are certain specific microorganisms known to produce enzymes. Now their biological source is Bacillus polymyxa, Bacillus cereus, Bacillus megaterium, Streptomyces species, Pseudomonas species and Rhizoporus japonicus. Let's move to the application of amylase enzyme. These enzymes have a very large number of applications. We will study most important in it. First, production of sweeteners for the food industry. Example, glucose syrup, high mannose syrup and high fructose syrup. 2. Dextrin. The short chain polymer dextrins are produced by the hydrolysis of starch with amylases, which is followed by the disaccharide maltose and ultimately glucose, that is a monosaccharide. Third, maltose syrup, which contains less than 80% of the maltose. Maltose with a less than 80 bricks, which is specifically produced primarily in Japan, is of low viscosity, weakly hygroscopic, slightly sweet and not a crystallizable. However, possesses two remarkable characteristic features, namely 1. Which shows a good heat stability, b. Which fails to undergo browning reaction. Next use is glucose isomerase. It is used invariably to convert glucose into the fructose, that is isomer of glucose. Because the former is not nearly as sweet as the latter, therefore most of the commercial sweeteners based upon fructose do possess a certain viable economic and manufacturing advantages over the conventional, rather more widely used sweetener sucrose. Dear friends, up till now you have gained a fair idea about what are enzymes along with the profile of amylase enzyme. If you have missed any of the module or content, you may log on to our website www.cec.nic.in to download videos, FAQs, LOR and other content so that you can stay updated with our chapter. Now let's move ahead in our next module, that is about the study of protease. Module 3, study of protease. Protease, also called as proteolytic enzymes, they refer to a class of enzyme that exclusively break down or hydrolyze the peptide bond, that is CONH bond, which joins the array of amino acid in a protein. Based on a broad survey of literature, it is now possible to classify proteases into 5 distinct categories, namely alkaline proteases, neutral proteases, acid proteases, fungal proteases and bacterial proteases. Let's study sources of these proteases enzymes one by one. Alkaline protease. A good number of organisms and fungi prominently excrete alkaline protease. The biological source, organism, Bacillus strain, example, Bacillus amyloliquificans, Bacillus firmus, Bacillus lichenoformis. Streptomyces strains, example, Streptomyces fridis, Streptomyces griseus and Streptomyces rectus. Fungi, Aspergillus strains, example, Aspergillus flavus, Aspergillus niger, Aspergillus oryzae and Aspergillus sojae. Neutral proteases. Evidently, both bacteria and fungi are responsible for the excretion of neutral proteases. Their biological source, Bacillus cereus, Bacillus megaterium, Bacillus subtilis, Pseudomonas aeruginosa, Streptomyces griseus, Aspergillus oryzae, Aspergillus sojae and Pericularia oryzae. Acid proteases essentially include renin like proteases obtained from the fungi which are mostly employed in a commercial production of cheese. Fungal proteases. A number of fungi give rise to production of fungal proteases in an appropriate good yield. Biological sources, Mucor dilemer, Aspergillus flavus, Aspergillus oryzae, Aspergillus venti, Amylomyces roxy. Bacterial proteases. Bacillus subtilis is the strain of choice for the bacterial protease production. However, the fermentative parameters remain virtually the same employed for the amylase production by this organism. It has already been established that the Bacillus strain particularly selected for higher protease activity and not for the amylase activity. Now coming to its application part. Commercial application of proteases. The numerous legitimate application of the proteases are as given under. 1. Primarily extensively in the detergent industry. 2. Employed extensively in a dairy industry, example reining. 3. For baiting of hides in a leather industry, whether by enzyme cause adequate alterations in a hides to provide a finer grain and texture, greater pliability, besides an overall improved general quality. 4. Proteases are also find their uses in a textile industry to afford proteinaceous sizing. 5th. In a silk industry, proteases help in a liberation of the silk fibers from the naturally occurring proteinous material wherein they are actually embedded. 6. Proteases like pepain are also employed as a meat tenderizer. 7. As an active and vital component in the most spot remover preparation for removing food spots in a dry cleaning industry. 8. Pharmaceutical industry also do make use of proteases in the manufacture of certain highly. Module 4. Study of streptodornase. Streptodornase refers to one of the enzymes produced by certain strains of hemolytic streptococci. It is capable of liquefying fibrinous and purulent exudate. It is also employed sometime as a wound debridement, that is removal of damaged tissue. Streptodornase is actually obtained from the Streptococcus hemolyticus that efforts depolymerization of polymerized deoxyribonucleoproteins. It is used extensively in conjunction with streptokinase as dislogging agent to cleanse ulcer and promote the healing process progressively. Module 5, immobilization of bacteria. Before we move on to the next module of immobilization of bacteria, we'll quickly recap the topics we have learned till now. We discuss amylases, proteases and streptodonase along with their biological sources and application. Now that we are familiar with the enzymes, let's start with the immobilization of bacteria and plant cell. First, we'll see what is immobilization is. Immobilization particularly refers to the imprisonment of a biocatalyst in a distinct phase which is necessarily permits only exchange but clearly separated from the bulk phase wherein the substrate, effector and inhibitor molecules are adequately dispersed and monitored. The immobilization of bacteria, that is organism, may be explained by the help of fermentation of E. coli for the production of cytidine deaminase. It is well known that cytidine deaminase is extensively distributed among the microorganism where its physiological role is confined to scavenge specifically exogenous and endogenous cytidine. However, in a particular instance of enteric bacteria, for instance, Escherichia coli and Salmonella typhimurium, the enzyme is appreciably inducible to high levels, thereby permitting these organisms to grow rapidly with cytidine as an exclusive source of nitrogen. Therefore, it is worthwhile and also logical to look into E. coli as a source of large quantities of enzyme for actual uses in a production of lamivudine, that is zafexin, ipivir and antiviral drug. It has been demonstrated that cytidine deaminase production by two variants of E. coli strains JM103 and B with and without cytidine are given in the table which is shown on your screen. Based on the above finding, one will expect that actual production to be approximately 10 folds as the grade in the presence of cytidine. In order to obviate the need to add cytidine to the fermentation broth, a constitutive mutant was virtually sought by Munich Peterson, who suggested that in Escherichia coli, both cytidine deaminase and uridine phosphorylase are coordinatingly expressed under the direct control of the site R repressor. It has been observed that the expression of both gene is duly induced by the cytidine but not by the uridine. As a result, the specific mutant which may grow progressively upon uridine are likely to have defective site R gene and therefore will express both enzymes constitutively. Nevertheless, the enzyme production by the constitutive mutant was just sufficient to support biotransformation process at a responsible substantial scale. However, for production scale, one may even require a still better source and type of enzyme. Such a challenge and Herculean task was duly accomplished by the cloning the cytidine deaminase gene, that is CDD, onto multicopy plasmid under the control of delta PL promoter. Subsequently, the ensuing plasmid delta PL CDD E was strategically introduced into the E. coli TG1 by transformation, thereby attributing resistance to the tetracycline. Thus, the recombinant strain E. coli TG1 afforded ultimately an extremely high level of cytidine deaminase production. Importantly, the specific activity was found to be raised comfortably up to 80 times than that accomplished with the constitutive mutant. Now, let's move to the next module, that is module 6, immobilization of plant cell. Immobilization of plant cells have recently been developed as an alternative methodology to the age-old suspension cultures for the exclusive production of secondary metabolite, that is, such metabolites which are known to be very necessary to plant life, many of them providing a defense mechanism against bacterial, viral and fungal attack, analogous to the immune system of the animals. Immobilize the plant cells for agriculture. In the recent past, the enormous application of microbial inoculants have gained a tremendous momentum in ever expanding a domain of agriculture that will be anchored to the following four solid supporting facts, namely apparent noticeable increments in the symbiotic or associative nitrogen fixation, biological control and management of soil-borne plant pathogens, spectacular reduction in aflatoxin contents and biodegradation of xenobiotic compounds. It is, however, pertinent to emphasize at this juncture that in these bioactive processes, the critical survival of the microbes under the biotic as well as abiotic prevalent stresses emanated in the soil possess a major limitation. It has also been amply advocated that immobilization of microbial cells via various modes, example, entrapment, encapsulation, etc. In these specific instances, it has been proved to cater for adequate protection against these prevailing stresses. Example, the two typical examples are as given below. Microbial cells, which are entrapped in alginate, these cells did survive against the environmental hazards of the soil, whereas the actual survival of the free cells, that is, the untrapped one, was minimized astronomically under the prevailing drying, welting cycles in soil parameters. The second example is algal biofertilizers. In this particular instance, the algal biofertilizers, the phenomenon of immobilization not only displayed a positive edge in efficacy but also afforded a definite advantage. Tissue culture. Tissue culture refers to the growth of tissues in vitro on artificial media exclusively for experimental research. It is indeed a stark reality that tissues culture has immensely facilitated the techniques of microbial genetics as applicable specifically to higher plant cells. One may strategically induce genetic variability in relatively large homogeneous population of plant cells by adequate exposure to either chemical or physical mutagens. Thus, it is not quite possible to prepare in the same state for as long as one may desire. As a result, each single cell may prove to be good as a potential bacterial cell for affording induction and followed by isolation of mutants and variants. Nevertheless, the importance of cell culture depends upon the mutatious development of methodologies for enabling the isolation of broad spectrum of cultured cell strains having apparent characteristic features that are entirely different from those of cells in the original cultures. Therefore, in order to isolate such obvious variant cell strains, established techniques in microbial studies may have to be enforced judiciously in a cultured plant cell system. Now, we'll see application of mutagens to the plant cells. It is regarded to be an especially important methodology to enhance the ensuing frequency of variant strains in a population of cells so that they may easily be identified and conveniently selected. The vigorous and constant search for the chemicals that are virtually effective from a broad spectrum of plant cells is invariably considered to be an important aspect of plant somatic cells mutant isolation. In order to ascertain whether or not a particular substance is mutagenic exclusively depends upon the expression of an easily observed characteristic features such as resistance to specific nucleic acid precursor analog termed as 6-azo-uracil present profusely different in a parent cell and the subsequent variants derived from them after due treatment with the agent. Interestingly, the parent cell growing in a culture are highly sensitive to this compound, whereas the variant which are apparently resistant to it may be observed explicitly. And this is difference forms the fundamental basis of its assay. It has been established beyond any reasonable doubt that the ensuing difference is caused due to highly deficient enzyme present in a variant cells, which is known as a uracil phosphoribosyl transferase, and this actually affords a sidal action upon the cells. There are in fact two predominant strains of cells duly obtained from two altogether different species of plants, namely haploid Datura enoxia and diploid Haplopappus gracilis, that are found to be exerting resistance to this particular analog, have been meticulously isolated and exhibited to lack the aforesaid enzyme, that is uracil phosphoribosyl transferase. Salient features of mutagens to plant cells. Following are the some salient features of mutagen to plant cells. 1. Higher plants, example Nicotina tabacum, and ferns, example Todia barbara, Osmunda cinnamonea helped in a big way for carrying out such studies. 2. Several varieties of auxotropic mutants that essentially require amino acids and vitamins have been skillfully raised in a Tobia barbara. 3. Mutants that absolutely requiring amino acids, purines and vitamins have been isolated with utmost success in the Nicotina tabacum. 4. Mutants that offer resistance to streptomycin and antibiotic 8-azoguanine and 5-bromo-2-deoxyuridine base analog have been isolated in higher plants as well. 5. Auxotropic and resistant mutants are of utmost importance in carrying out the analysis of genetic linkage, complementation and recombination. 6. Inhibitors do play a major and pivotal role in a deciphering of various metabolic pathways in vivo. Thus, by using different metabolic inhibitors, one may conveniently affect virtually complete blockade of the cellular metabolism at a specific site, and therefore, by critically examining the fallout of such a blockages, it becomes a lot easier to know exactly the nature of the pathway and also the factor responsible for controlling the entire process. 7. Inhibitors also help to control several cardinal functionalities, for instances, a specific step in a DNA and RNA, protein anabolism and metabolic process of an organism. 8. Mutants also throw sufficient in-depth knowledge with regards to appropriate selection of products emanated due to fusion occurring between the cells of variant genetic backgrounds or antecedents. 9. Mutants solve a host of fundamental biological intricated problems to a great extent. 10. Mutants recovered carefully from the culture plant cells are really of tremendous biotechnological importance and may serve as the basis of unfolding a good number of complex agricultural, industrial and nutritional problems speedily and logically. Now move to the conclusion. As enzymes are biological catalysts that promotes the rate of reactions but are not themselves consumed in the reactions. They may be used repeatedly for as long as they remain active. However, in most of the process, enzymes are mixed in a solution with substrate and cannot be economically recovered after the reaction are generally wasted. Thus, there is an incentive to use an enzyme immobilized or insolubilized form so that they may be retained in a biochemical reactor for the further catalysis. This is done by the enzyme immobilization, which may be defined as the process whereby the movement of enzyme, cell, organelles in a space is completely or severely restricted, usually resulting in a water insoluble form of the enzyme. Immobilized enzymes are also sometimes referred to as a sound, insolubilized, supported or matrix linked enzyme. With all this information, here we come to the end of the today's lecture. Do keep in mind what we discussed today. It's time for you all to do some self-study. This is Parshuram signing off. If you want to learn more and enhance your knowledge, you may log on to our website for MCQ, quizzes, LOR, www.cec.nic.in. Till then, keep studying. Goodbye.